So continuing on the subject matter of Leo Strauss's introductory remark on the nature of politics, that all the political actions are for the sake of improvement or conservation, and that leads to a great many things. Let's see what can be shown on the basis of looking at the first part of the statement, the political action. So how does Strauss understand political action in contradistinction to other forms of action, artistic action or physical action or poetic action or some other kind of action? So I think Angela Davis produces a good example with her understanding of Rosa Parks' action of refusing to go to the back of the bus. So she says Rosa Parks is usually presented as though she were just tired and she had enough that day and she just refused to go to the back of the bus or something along those lines, but that in fact she was a dedicated activist and that this was a deliberate political action, even though of course she may have also been tired and the rest of it. So I think that's pretty good. It's the political action is in this sense a deliberate action. It's not just something happens. It's not just anything that happens in the city is a political action. Political action is, at the risk of being misunderstood, it's a rational action, which doesn't mean it's correct, but it means it's based on moving about in this region of activity of the human being proper. Thinking about the improvement, as the rest of the sentence says, the improvement or the conservation of the political body, but moving, we should not forget, moving in the region of what we could call God, I suppose, or which is to say God's intellect. So because these statements that we're talking about with Strauss, if they're true, they're meant to not be just true for a few weeks, but always true. So, okay, another, they're eternal in the mind of God, or however one wants to state it, or proposed to be, according to this Western way of thinking, the Platonic way of thinking. Another example, I think, that Strauss himself has touched on is the example of Raskolnikov. So it's not that Raskolnikov is just going around, you know, killing people because he sort of got upset that this Lizaveta, or no, that's the character, Brothers Karamazov, but whatever the name is of the sister of the old, what is it, the pawnbroker, who was being somehow mistreated. He just decides to kill her and take the money or something out of spontaneously or whatever, or for some other reason, some low reason. But Strauss says is, no, he had a principle. So he did it with a deliberate notion to demonstrate apparently some form of utilitarianism. So in certain subtle cases, a superior individual, Galileo, I guess, is one of the examples he gives, who's about right on the edge of proving something, could possibly commit a crime in order to prove this thing, which is meant to be of great efficacy for human beings as such. So this, this which Kant excludes, this sort of let's make a deal, and if the benefit is great enough, then it's possible to commit what would otherwise be a crime, but it wouldn't be a crime. Which, I mean, I suppose is in some way always presented as a problem for state actors, but not quite in this, somehow it couldn't be in that form because the state can't know the inner state of someone who has a genius for some pursuit which is going to pay off in a large way for human beings as such. So in that juxtaposition between mere action, what's just happening, somebody does something for whatever reason, and political action which somehow touches on this apparent presentation of a dictate of reason, something that reason commands, as it were, an ought in the proper sense, a command from the intellect of God, the eternal intellect of God. So far as they're touching on this reason as the essence of the human being, they're involved in the political act. So far as they're not, they're just mulling around and doing other things. This moving back and forth is like the question of the being involved in life and then raising up to the other, to the truth. So it's interesting that Alan McFarland gives this, says that in his view, probably the reason why heresy and the heretic never played any role in East Asia is because of the lack of this notion of truth. There's no such notion of truth in this sense in East Asia, and therefore you can't have heretics, because the heretics are the ones that are denying these things which are eternal verities in the intellect of